morning.
Welcome to United Church of Hyde Park. It seems like we're coming in, we're getting settled. It's a new year. Billy told me, and he's our greeter, that I should say to all of you all this morning, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
It's important that I hit that. So I wanted to wish you a Happy New Year. If you are a visitor, we have blue cards. We'd love for you to fill that out. Tell us a little bit about yourself, and when the offering comes, you can put it in the offering plate. As well, our moderator wanted me to remind you all, or not remind you, let you know.
You got it.
That the town hall meeting that we were supposed to be having this month has been changed. As we are planning with the community felt like we needed a little longer to plan our town hall meeting. So we don't want you guys showing up for the town hall meeting, and we will let you know when it's rescheduled. It is so good to see some of us gather back together after the holidays, however you celebrate it. I want to welcome you, whether you are setting new goals or continuing the goals you have from last year or all of it. Humbug! It is so good to have you in this place. We welcome you, welcome all of you to United Church of Hyde Park.
Please stand and join me in the call to worship. On this day, we remember the gifts of God's word.
He gathers us together from the farthest parts of the world to worship and joy and hope.
On this day, we remember the simple graces of the bread and the
those plain gifts shaped by God's love into nourishing hope.
On this day, we remember the gifts of water and the oil.
Cleanse us in the baptismal pools, anointing us as God's children.
Please remain standing for the hymn of the Three Kings, which is hymn number 254. A note that's not in the bulletin, we will only be singing verses 1, 2, and 5. So just verses 1, 2, and 5.
Clear, we came from the Lord and come.
that might have been put away. We have the stacks of Christmas cards, but we memorize the words soon as us. We set limits on who we will love. We make promises we cannot keep. We fail to see the pain and hurt we cause. God of the angels and shepherds, forgive us. Your word has come to reshape our lives. Your light has come to show us the way home. Your son has come to make us your family. Have mercy and make us new people. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let us take a moment to pray in silence. Like the baby of Bethlehem, we are born anew. God's forgiveness cradles us. God's love is poured out on us.
What a marvelous gift, forgiveness, filled with hope and new life. We can sing God's praises forever. Amen.
Amen. Again, it is so good to see you all on this first Sunday. And it's so good to hear. I really mean it about the baby. Now, these little kids down here are challenging me a little, but the baby. So again, I just want to welcome you all to United. This is the part in our worship celebration where we get to go to each other, where we get to get up out of our seats and go to one another and share some greetings. It's the tradition of our church to say, may the peace of Christ be with you. And the response is,
and also with you.
If that's too many words for you, just say whatever, you know, like hello, good morning, God bless you. The intent is that we share peace and we share a little bit of kindness with one another and we reach over boundaries and we reach across division to be united. May you rise and let this tradition begin.
Say hi to the baby.
No, I'm just kidding.
I love you.
Thank you.
given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
The second scripture reading comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14, which can be found in your pew Bible on page 949. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us for the foundation of the world, to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed upon us in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ, we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise and his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward the redemption as God's own people to the praise of his glory. Here ends the reading.
I'd like to spending my time with you this morning and talking about reframing our mindset. In our present day world, it can be easy to forget who we are, and that we are people that are called to be thankful. It can be easy to lose our way. It can be easy to get distracted by all kinds of stuff that should not matter, but somehow it comes to matter to us. We can easily think we're in control of our destiny and our fate. We can so easily get caught up in busying ourselves. We can so easily think we're relying on our savings and our own abilities. We can so easily find security in things, and when the bottom gets pulled out from under us, we're really thrown off. We can easily become complacent with life and become focused on me, myself, and my family. We can easily get deterred by tragedy and sorrow and loss that pulls the stability of the ground we are standing on right from underneath of us. We can get discouraged by naysayers, right, and negative energy that sometimes is around us, and sometimes even in us. We forget that we are not alone in this world, that we are not on our own. We are not all by ourselves. And we need to be reminded that, hey, maybe we can reframe our mindset. On our way to catch our plane, I packed up lunch because the airport wasn't going to yank my money up with those overrated prices. So I fixed me in Josiah because I knew right about the time we get to the airport, he was going to start talking about he was hungry, right? So I packed up us some food. I was excited. We were prepared. Everything was together. We were halfway to the airport, my luggage in tow. A man approaches us and says he's starving. He asks for money. He doesn't just ask for money. He asks for others. I've got the luggage. Josiah's got the gold pot. My mind hit flash on my food as I thought about those biscuits lathered with butter and sausage and cheese and eggs in between. I thought that they were going to make a good lunch. So I thought about it for a moment, and I waited. Before I could respond, Josiah looked to me and said, should we give him our food? Of course, we gave the man our food. And within minutes, he ate everything. I imagine it tasted just as good to him the way he ate. And I was so overcome with how fast he ate it. I hate to tell y'all, I tried to act cool, but the tears were starting to come to my eyes. We didn't solve world hunger that day, but I was reminded of the parallel relationship between God and us, and us and others. I was reminded of the need to reframe my mindset, how important the human in front of us is in every day that God sends our world. Reminding me how important it is to reframe our mindset. In the biblical text today, the one in John, it's an opportunity for us to remember, and by remembering, to reframe our mindset. The author reminds us that in the beginning, God was there. It's not working. Y'all said no all together. Jesus. This is not working? Okay. Is this helpful?
Yes.
In the biblical, now I gotta reframe this, y'all help me. I gotta reframe my mind about these mites. Wait, can help me. So in the biblical text today is an opportunity for us to remember, and by remembering, to reframe our mindset. The author reminds us in the beginning, God was there, yes, baby, before us and all of our ancestors and even humans, that God existed. Before animals and dinosaurs, there was God. Before any life form, there was God. It also reminds us that at a certain time in human history, God stepped in by sending God's Son to help us out. Strategic decisions, strategic moves. God does not just remain spirit out there, but becomes flesh, the totality of us. Flesh means mind, soul, and body. God stepped into our world of mistakes and sorrow to break the slippery, slow path that we were on. God stepped into our world when hope was all but gone, and God gave us Jesus. instructions on what to do if there's an emergency. I always say to myself, this is a waste of time. If there was an emergency, we would all act crazy and would act like we didn't remember anything they told us. But in any case, they tell us what to do if there is an emergency. Jesus is like our emergency plan. In seminary, we call this incarnation, when God becomes human. In Jesus, we see the face of God. In John, there are no babies and no mangers, no adoring shepherds or wise men from the east, just an incredible story of God becoming like us through Christ so that we may become like God through Jesus. It is very important for us to keep our eyes on Jesus, reframing our mindset, because Jesus comes full of grace, which translated is shiploads of grace, shiploads of cargo. That's a lot of grace. Back when my son was in the first grade, he was a bit of an adventure in school. We were not the perfect family. I love looking at perfect families. You know how the parents act beautiful, the kids, they have these wonderful stories, the kids do well in school, the parents are just outstanding, they always respond right. That is not us. We are struggling, we're yelling, we're mad, we make up, we love each other. And my son goes to school and acts a stone cold fool. So one of these weeks, it was like, it was the week. It was a Friday. And my son was saying to me, he was looking forward to TV. And we talk about consequences, how every action has a consequence. And I began to talk to him about his actions and the consequences. And then in the minute of my Nobel Peace Prize speech, he says to me in the first grade at 6 years old, what about grace? Now you would think because he was the son of a pastor, I had taught him about grace, but I had not been talking about grace at all. So immediately I was in awe of this child. I began to wonder how had he learned about grace when I hadn't even talked about it. And so I did what I do second best. I asked questions. So, son, where did you hear about grace? And he starts talking about his first grade teacher and how the first grade teacher told the class that grace is about something that is given to you when you haven't earned it, when you haven't done really anything to deserve it, but it's something that is shown to you in the way of kindness. I was not only impressed that the first grade teacher was teaching him grace in a public school. I was impressed that he got the concept and he used it well. On that Friday night, my son got TV. He used it a couple more times and it didn't work as well. Jesus comes to us full of grace. Grace for us. Grace that not necessarily we earned or deserved, but grace. This text reminds us that God came in the form of Jesus to earth, full of grace for us. That ought to reframe our mindset. In the play Green Pastures, which ran for many years on Broadway, playwright Mark Connelly has a moving and memorable scene. The Lord is anxiously looking out over the heaven, trying to decide what to do with the declining situation on earth. Anybody know about the declining situation on earth? Gabriel enters with his horn tucked under his arm. Sensing the Lord's number, he brushes his lips across the trumpet to keep the fill of it and asks, Lord, has the time come for me to blow the trumpet? No, no, said the Lord, don't touch the trumpet, not yet. God continues to worry with the problem. Gabriel asked the Lord again, what does he plan to do? Will he send someone to tend to the situation? Who will it be? Gabriel begins to make some suggestions to God. What about David? What about Moses? You could send one of the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah. There are lots of great prophets up there. What do you think, Lord? Without looking back at Gabriel, God said, I am not going to send anyone. This time, I'm going myself. May we be reminded this Christmas that God came down to earth, God's self. Jesus coming to earth was God coming as God's Son. And God, Jesus, brought lots of grace. The church is being challenged to reframe its vision, not just United, but the church in general. It's been hard for most churches, but because it's easy to do what we've always done. The comfort of who we have been is a real temptation before us. The comfort of just trying to do what we've always been doing, but to do it a little bit better and a little bit more modern is a temptation. The church, however, is being called like never before to ask the question and to shift and to reframe how we see, understand church in our time. We have a marquee out front, and generally on the marquee, we put down when open breakfast is happening, and we put down the sermon. People read our marquee. I've actually seen people stop and look up and read. You'd be surprised how many folks kind of stop and read. A while ago, Cal said to me, "Hey, what do you think about putting up some witty sayings?" Well, at first I thought, no, because I'm in love with my own sermon titles, right? But anyway, we're talking about reframing mentality. And sometimes reframing our mindset, we're willing to try and do things differently. Trying something different. So last fall, we experienced with the marquee, and we put up the first one, "We are not Culver's, but we have great Sundays." And that went right over 80% of the congregation's head. What is a Culver's, Bobby? Never mind, they serve good Sundays, really good Sundays. I was talking to a friend, she was like, "I love their Sundays." I was like, "Well, my church doesn't know about them." So we played some more, and then we went back to sermon titles. And then, again, we tried a different billboard or a different title this Christmas. And the first time in my tenure, being here 3 years, I had four random folks to walk up to me and say, "Hey, I love that marquee." I had two people on Facebook. While I was on vacation, someone posted and said, "I couldn't stop laughing when I walked by your marquee inside." I had an open breakfast patron said, "Hey, I saw that. I get your point. I get what you're trying to say." So much for sermon titles. Walking down the street, other people looked up at our marquee. We think it might be a sermon or it might be a song. But if we reframe our mentality, I was going to cool breeze and sermon and look chilly. Reframe our mindset, maybe we can play with our marquee. Maybe we can play with our whole outside. As United, we can say a lot about who we are right on our lawn when we begin to think about reframing our mindset. Martin Luther King Sunday is coming up in a couple of weeks, and I'd love to invite and challenge you all to submit sayings by Martin Luther King that are 15 words or less, because we can only use so many words. And I know a lot of Dr. King's words are like 30 words long. I mean, he really wrote some deep stuff. But there are some short things. So I invite you, let's share our narrative in downtown Hyde Park because more people are reading our marquee. In a world where marketing is important, we have a way of communicating a message. And too much of the other message is being communicated. How about communicating that we stand to the left of right? This year, I invite each of you to find new ways to reframe your mentality, to reframe your mindset. We not just have a beautiful lawn, but we sit in a prime spot. We not just sit in a prime spot, but we have a really dynamic group of folks. And not all of us are being utilized. And so maybe some of us could serve in different capacities. There will be church meetings, and there will be workshops, and there will be town hall meetings, and lots of opportunities for all of us to enter into what it means to reframe our mindset as a church that looks outward and no longer expects people to come and sit inward inside of our church. Reframe reframing our mindset impacts how we operate. I couldn't believe it. While on vacation, I had this opportunity to watch an evangelical movie called Overcomer. If you know how liberal I am, this is a miracle in and of itself. But it's about a young teenage girl who lost both of her parents to drugs, or so she thought. She's being raised by her grandmother. Her grandmother is her maternal grandmother. Her grandmother has never given her father for getting her mom on drugs that would take her life. The grandmother is bitter, and she is mad. She raises this girl, but she works mostly. This girl has a stealing problem. This girl has a mentality program. She never really felt good about who she was. All she knows is she has two parents that are losers and a grandmother that's bitter. The only thing she can do good is run. Her vision of herself is love. But the principle is a love Jesus principle. And she evangelizes this girl. And she leads her through the center prayer, and the girl becomes a Christian. She asked the girl to read Ephesians, which is amazing. It's the Ephesians passage today. When I saw this movie this week, I did not know that we were going to be reading the Ephesian passage. So I feel like it's a little bit spiritual. But she tells her to read the exact passage that we heard read by Stephanie today. And in that passage, the girl reads, I am chosen. I am not a mistake. I am loved by God. I am forgiven. For all the stealing I've done, I am forgiven. Well, for the girl, she had never heard that about herself. And she begins to cry. She had felt like a mistake. She had felt indifferent. She had felt like nobody really cared that she was even on the earth. And yet, through Ephesians, she begins to feel like maybe she wasn't a mistake. And she begins to cry. She takes these words to heart, but something else happens. She has a new vision of herself. She has a new mentality. She has a new mindset of who she is, and this changes her. We are chosen. We are chosen as God's people. We are holy. We are forgiven. We have grace that is lavished upon us. And because that grace is lavished upon us, we should lavish that grace on others. Vision is everything. Mindset is everything. Our mindset of ourselves and our church is everything. Amen.
Thank you.
your giving. If you're thinking to yourself, I've got bills to pay, that's going to impact your giving. If you're thinking, I only got this much left, it impacts your giving. But if your mindset is, I am abundantly blessed, and I want to be a blessing in my church, it impacts your giving. We challenge you to challenge your mindset, to share your financial resources in this new year, in this new Sunday. We invite you to share your resources with United. At this time, I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. You who come to me shall not hunger. You who believe in me shall never thirst."
In company with all who hunger for spiritual food, we come to this table to know the risen Christ in the sharing of this life-giving bread.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High. Eternal God, who was created, who has created the heavens and earth, giving breath to every living being, we thank you for all of the gifts of creation and the gift of life itself. We rejoice in Jesus Christ, the only one eternal begotten by you, who was born of your servant Mary and shared the joys and sorrows of life as we know it. We remember Christ's death. We remember Christ's resurrection. We remember that Christ will return again. We take courage from the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit in our midst. We offer our praise for witness in every age to your love and your justice. Holy, 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 Lord God of love and majesty. The whole universe speaks of your glory, O God Most High. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We remember on the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and said to the disciples, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." On the same night, eating a meal with the disciples, he took the new covenant after supper, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you. Likewise, do this in remembrance of me." By eating this bread and drinking this cup, we proclaim Christ's death, Christ's resurrection. We proclaim that Christ will return again. Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask you to bless this bread and cup and all of us with the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Through this meal, make us the body of Christ, the church, your servant people, that we might be salt, that we might be light and leaven for the furtherance of your will in all the world. Amen.
Amen.
You can come to this table any way you want. You can come and it can just be some grape juice and some bread. Or with the right mindset, you can come to this table and know what Christ has done for you, and it can be personal. I ask the service to come forward at this time. Are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come for all things of earth. Let us pray. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love, and send us forward into this world with courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of your Holy Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Even the baby saying amen.
I heard it. That was an amen. This is the time in our service where we do prayers of the people. And so we invite you in very one or two sentences to say your concern. So are there any, my head, I'm getting this messed up. Are there any concerns today? Ina Grace.
Well, you were talking about the outside of the building and the banner that we put on the, where the doors, on the corner doors for the breakfast and other events seems to have disappeared. It may have gotten folded up and put someplace that none of us know. So if anybody knows where it might be, please see me or Pam. What's it say? Celebrating God's love, United yes. Church of Hyde Park.
I don't know if they liked it so much. And then that would be wonderful evangelism as well. Come, Holy Spirit. Lord, fix this mic.
You're good right now.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Hear our prayers.
Any other prayers of the people?
Marcia, I pray for my friend Barbara's niece, Nancy, who's having a wrist surgery on Tuesday, that it goes well.
Lifting up Nancy and her surgery coming up on Tuesday, come, Holy Spirit.
Hear our prayers.
Stephanie.
I just want to lift up our Methodist denomination who announced this week that there will be a split. So just praying for all the churches as they discern their path.
The Methodists are still struggling, and there is talk about a split. And we need to lift up the Methodist denomination. Come, Holy Spirit.
Hear our prayers.
Ina Grace.
I heard on the news that hundreds of thousands of people were killed in the Iran-Iraq war. And that area, unfortunately, is not afraid of people dying. So just have a grave concern about the tensions between our country and Iran and what might come of it.
Lifting up the tension between Iran, Iraq, and the United States of America, come Holy Spirit. Rachel.
I need a prayer for a friend who had got hit by a car by a drunk driver. He goes to the palace. His name is Robert James. He got hit by a car. The young man.
We're lifting up Robert James, who was hit by a car. Lifting up Rachel's friend who was hit by a car, who's in a coma. We want to lift up that person as well as the drunk robber who hit him as well. Come, Holy Spirit. Yes, ma'am. Janelle wants to lift up the soldiers who have now been deployed back to Iran. Come, Holy Spirit. June?
Yes, I'd like prayers for the family off of 72nd and South Shore Drive, I believe. The mom and two
just the two kids. Lifting up that situation, come Holy Spirit. Wait, Jen.
This coming Saturday, young people in my country, Taiwan, will vote for our new president. So hopefully everything will go well. Mm-hmm.
Wei Jin is lifting up his home of origin. They will be voting on a new president and hoping that things go well. Come, Holy Spirit. No, he's talking about Taiwan.
Right.
Laura. Lifting up Australia and the impact of the firestorm, come Holy Spirit. Yes.
For all beings who are in need of our Heavenly Father's love, compassion, grace, and for Mother Nature.
Lifting up all human beings in need of God's love, come Holy Spirit. Yes. Lifting up our president and guidance for him. Come, Holy Spirit.
Hear our prayers.
Man, God, you got a lot going on up here. Just me.
Yeah, that the homeless have the proper buildings to live in, food, housing, clothing, everything they need.
Lifting up our homeless population and all that goes with that. Come, Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Dear Lord, there is so much happening in our world that troubles us, our spirit, that calls us to pray without ceasing, that calls us to reach out to you and ask for your intervention, and ask for your guidance. You have heard the prayers of your people. Come, Holy Spirit. Hear our prayers like never before. We now lean into a prayer that has been tried on and stretched and practiced through the centuries that you taught to the disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. We're about to dismiss, but even as we leave, let us continue to pray for those things that were never done, and to pray for those things that were unspoken, that God brings to our spirit. Happy New Year. We're going to sing in closing an insert, New Mercies, New Blessings. Let us stand together and sing our closing hymn.
into your world with a new mindset. Send us into John the Baptist, bearing witness that Jesus has come, bearing witness to life, bearing witness to love, bearing witness to grace. In Jesus' name, amen.